Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Knox. We're glad you have joined with us on our Sunday morning service, April 26th, the third Sunday of Eastertide, where we're invited to listen to the story of the two disciples who met the risen Lord on the way to Emmaus. We learn also how that incident changed their lives ever after. Please join with me in lighting the Christ candle. As we light the memorial candle this morning, we remember the people of Nova Scotia. Canadians across the country are mourning after the news of this senseless act of terrorism that happened last weekend. Let us pray for the families and friends at this time in Nova Scotia. O God, we are mourning with the people of Nova Scotia this morning, this tragic loss. O God, we ask you to pour out your strength and comfort on those families, friends, and communities who are affected by this incident. O God, we pray for the people of Nova Scotia. May they know that they are not alone. May they know that you are with them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now please join with me in the call to worship. We need your presence on the long road, Lord, the road between fear and hope, the road between the place where all is lost and the place of resurrection. Like the disciples walking the road to Emmaus, we are in need of your company. Jesus, stand among us in your risen power. Let this time of worship and be a hallowed hour. The opening hymn this morning is The Risen Christ, Voices United, hymn number 168.
Every land, till all are led.
Please join with me in the opening prayer in bold print on your screen. Lord Jesus Christ, say with us, too, we pray. In every part of our journey, no matter how full of doubt or fear we may be today, through your Holy Spirit, open our eyes. Help us see you as our risen Lord, in all your beauty and in all your loving power. Jesus said, I pray then like this. Let us sing the Lord's Prayer together. Assurance of God's grace. Jesus asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" As Jesus appeared and disappeared, their eyes were opened and they recognized him. Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. Stay with us, O God, and talk with us on our journey. Thanks be to God. The children's hymn today is All the Way My Savior Leads Me, Voices United, hymn number 635. And this is followed by Moment of Discovery by Jane Bossert.
From the rock before me, flow a spring of joy. Good morning, Knox United Church. Hi there, it's Miss Jane. Welcome. Glad you joined us this Sunday morning. Happy Easter. Easter isn't over, it's just begun. Because now we're really getting into understanding Christ's resurrection and all the scripture and amazing stories that tell us the wonder and amazement of what that means and what that looks like in our lives. And it's wonderful that it happens during springtime. Springtime is new life. New things. And I know it hasn't sort of felt like it lately. It's been pretty cold and it's even been snowing. But I promise spring is there. And if you look for it, you can see it. The daily blessings that only spring, hi Oreo, that only spring can bring. Well, I wanted to share a story with you, actually all about a bee. Because springtime, as you know, means new life, not only for understanding our new life in Jesus, but new life in nature. And this year was the 50th anniversary for Earth Day, which happened this past Wednesday, the 22nd. And how amazing that, hey buddy, you want to say good morning? Good morning, Oreo. My sweet little boy. Maybe I think he wants to hear the story too. So I wanted to read a special story to you. And one to celebrate Earth and just nature and just the beauty of the world around us. But listen to the words and see if you know where I might be going with it to share with you at the very end. All right, sit back, enjoy your coffee, enjoy a story. B. Dawn is breaking on a brand new day, and in the meadow, poppies sway. A bee appears, striped black and gold. A wonder of nature is about to unfold. I can even show you some of the pictures, I think. In the treetops, birds start to sing. The little bee beats her wings. As she travels here and there, a gentle humming fills the air. Back and forth, to and fro, bee knows exactly where to go, visiting flowers of every hue. She has a special job to do. Pictures are beautiful in this story. Gathering nectar as she goes, from every foxglove, every rose, dusty with pollen, the little bee buzzes, buzzes busily. Bee travels on from bloom to bloom, drawn in by their sweet perfume. Harvesting flowers one by one, her compass is the midday sun. Among the orchids, apple trees, blossoms quiver in the breeze. Carrying pollen from place to place, bee always leaves a tiny trace. Flowers as far as the eye can see. Too many flowers for just one bee. All of a sudden, bee is gone. But she has a message to pass on. Back at the hive. Oh, let me show you this picture. Oh, there's my other sweet girl, little Eve. Look at the beautiful flowers. Just gorgeous. Back at the hive, bee spreads the news. There's work to be done. No time to lose. Listen for their gentle humming. The word is out. The bees are coming. Buzzing over the dense hedge grows, past the pond where wild thyme grows. Through the orchard's sweet-smelling scent, the bees travel on with calm intent. As lilies glow orange in the sun, the bees must finish what they've begun. Stopping at every flower they find, leaving the gift of pollen behind. The bees pass over a woodland stream. Droplets sparkle and pebbles gleam. Water trickles, bubbles, and weaves. A weeping willow trails its leaves. As the bees fly on through buds and burrs, a tiny miracle occurs. So many plants and flowers you see were given life by one small bee. And that's the end of that simple, beautiful, poetic story. Yes, I'm a teacher. Love picture books. They can teach us so much. And this story, you know, didn't just touch on the beauty and wonder and importance of bees, but it also touched on God and the job that he had given Jesus. And Jesus needed his disciples. And he came to those disciples, and when the disciples were ready and willing and able to comprehend, they did. And they went out and they began to spread the news. And that's what we need to do. We need to love nature, love creatures, love creation, love each other, and spread the good news. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Be well, friends. Happy Easter.
Today's scripture lesson is taken from Luke chapter 24, verses 13 to 27. The walk to Emmaus. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word, before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish are you, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?' Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures." Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God.
Watching a romantic ending to a Disney movie, this 5-year-old girl sighed, "I hope I meet my prince someday." "Of course you will," the mother reassured her. "You know, I met my prince the day I met your daddy." Puzzled, the little girl said, "Who was he? Who was he?" That is the question that we often hear when we read the last parts of the gospel lessons. In particular, after the resurrection story, because they couldn't recognize Jesus. Mary couldn't recognize Jesus. She thought it was her gardener. Thomas wondered who he was. The two disciples on the way to Emmaus, they asked the same question: who on earth is this person? Who was he? Because they couldn't recognize. This past week, Kim and I, we just had a chance to visit the previous place we used to live before. I was going this way, and my wife was going the other way. Suddenly, this used to be my neighbor came up to me and told how his wife had a cancer and unexpectedly died. Within just a month, his whole world turned upside down. I didn't know what to say. I was in such a shock because I saw his wife and she looked fine before. I didn't know what to say, I said, but this man said, "Brian, that's okay. You don't have to say anything." When I finished that conversation with this gentleman, I was still in shock. I walked to Kim and I literally cried out, "Kim, I need a hug and a big hug." Wasn't having a midlife crisis. The point I want to make is we all die, don't we? Our heart is going to have one final heartbeat. This hand looks fine now, but it's going to fall limp. These lungs are going to exhale one last time. No one escapes death. One person said, "It's the most democratic institution on earth, allows no discrimination, tolerates no exceptions. The mortality of humankind is the same world over, one death per person." Even the psalmist says, "Who can escape the power of the grave? Young and old, good and bad, rich and poor, no gender is spared, no person is exempt. Julius Caesar died, John Lennon died, Elvis Presley died, Princess Diana died. Nearly two people a second, experts say, 6,000 people in an hour. The finest surgeon can enhance our lives, but they can never eliminate death. Pop all the pills, eat all the green vegetables, stay away from alcohol, but we never eliminate the inevitability of death. Isn't that a bummer? We just die. Or do we?" On the book Theology of Death, Karl Lerner, he said, "Death is not God's punishment, but we are rather invited to die with Christ and to die every day, practicing the life Jesus lived, the life of Jesus Christ, which conquers the absurdity of death. Death is not the end of the story, according to the Bible. There is something else beyond the death." What if this is just the first step? What if this is the first chapter? What if this is just the first sentence of the first chapter? What if this is just the first word, the first sentence of the first chapter in the whole story God is writing? I love the fact when John's Gospel says, first chapter, "In the beginning, the Word was with God." In the beginning, the Word was with God. The Word was God, made of flesh, lived with us. And it is interesting, at the end of the John's Gospel, Jesus tells the disciples, go to Galilee. Go to Galilee. Why Galilee? This is the place where Jesus started with the disciples. As if John's Gospel is trying to tell us that, let's do it again. Let's do it again. What if God can start again? What if God can start again even after this challenge of COVID-19? Mary and the disciples, they didn't see a phantom. They didn't experience sentiment. They saw Jesus, and Jesus assured them, "It is I, myself." According to John's Gospel, chapter 24, we don't know a lot about these two disciples. One person's name is Cleopas. One thing we know is that they had chosen to leave the city of Jerusalem, and they were going to this obscure small village in Emmaus. Scholars tell they're not even sure about where this place Emmaus is located. Jerusalem is ground zero for Christian movement, where all the action just happened, and they just decided to leave that space. One clue is in verse 17, their faces were downcast. They are disappointed, they are frustrated, and they walked away. They walked away. I love the fact that Jesus walked after them. "What are you guys talking about?" Jesus asked them. Cleopas, listen to this story. "What are you guys talking about?" Jesus asked them. Cleopas, he responds, not knowing who that person is, not recognizing who he is. "Don't you know all the things that just happened?" In today's term, "Don't you watch the TV? Don't you follow Facebook? Did you check your emails? Don't you know the things?" And verse 19, Jesus says, "What things?" What things? Question has a way of causing us to open up within our assumptions, causing us to reevaluate our biases, if we have any, and to ask where those biases correspond with reality. What things? So they talked about everything about Jesus, but they don't fully buy into the resurrection story yet. And then Cleopas probably jumps out. "We had hoped that he was the one who was going to save us." In their perspective, Jesus did not meet. In their perspective, Jesus died. In their perspective, they couldn't believe the resurrection. They were looking for Moses, some kind of prophet, history maker, mighty in word and deed. And they were discouraged because Jesus didn't meet their expectation. John Crossan once said, "Emmaus never happened. Emmaus always happens." Emmaus always happens when we think God is not meeting our expectation. Emmaus happens. But listen to the story. So they gave him, this total stranger, they thought, a broiled fish and some bread. Isn't it wonderful how the higher power is experienced there, Jesus eating fish and chips with the disciples? What is the writer of the gospel is trying to tell us? It is telling us that Jesus is not a symbol. Jesus is real. Jesus is here. Jesus is not just an impression in our mind. As Jesus tells the disciples, "Give me something to eat." Sounds so trivial. This story is just there, as if there's no other explanation, there's no other motivation the writer would have had to put it there. Resurrection was not preached as a symbolic representation of God's truth, but the resurrection was a paradigm-shattering but impossible to dismiss the fact. Our culture is about likes or dislikes, like Facebook. People looking for praises. The two disciples disliked the resurrection, but rather they found it offensive. But it didn't matter whether they like it or not. The message here is very clear, John 24. I don't care, according to John, the writer, because it is a fact. On the road to Emmaus, the two disciples to whom Jesus appeared, they saw a pilgrim, just like they didn't know who Jesus was, who this person was. They thought it was a stranger, and then Jesus broke the bread. And then they realized it was the risen Lord. And the story goes on. The two disciples return to Jerusalem. They return to the challenge. They return to face the issues, the problems. Their skepticism didn't matter because it was true. Oh, in the light of resurrection, if Jesus was resurrected, can you imagine with me this morning? If Jesus was resurrected, the cross makes sense. The skeptical can see the light. Wait a minute, if Jesus was raised from the dead, what about the word he said, the new heaven and new earth? What about the word he said, "Come to Galilee"? Could it be that he was meaning that, "Let's do it again. Let's do it again"? Recently, my family and I, while we are practicing our self-quarantine, we watched a movie, Back to the Future, classic Back to the Future. I'm sure some of you, many of you have watched the movie Back to the Future. What's the best scene in the movie? I believe the best scene is when George punches Biff at the party. We gave a well-deserved applause. But I knew how the story goes beforehand, so I was not all tied up in the plot, but rather appreciate clever dialogue, outstanding camera work, special effect, and on. But my children were different. They were on edge. Martin kept asking me, "Dad, what's gonna happen to him? What if he's not going back to his time?" That's how we can enjoy life, as if we are viewing it for the second time. If Jesus was resurrected from the dead. After resurrection, Jesus appeared to the disciples approximately 10 times according to Gospels. On that way to Emmaus, they were actually walking and talking with Jesus. But it says, here's the interesting part. But it says they were not able to recognize Jesus. They were not able to recognize Jesus. Back to the gentleman who lost his wife at the beginning of my story this morning. like I said, I didn't know what to say. And he said, knowing that I am a preacher, knowing that I am a believer, he said, the person who heartily go to church, he said, Brian, you don't have to say anything. The funeral was good with 400 attendants. My wife is in a different place with no more pain anymore. It was a good sermon. What if it was the Word of God then? What if we're not able to recognize Jesus? Amen. Our response of hymn today is Voices Unite, hymn number 184, As You Walk to Home at Close of Day. Let us pray the prayer of petition. Please join with me in the bold prints on your screen. Like the disciples at Emmaus, we offer what we have. They offered their company, their table, their bread. We invite you to be with us as we offer others our love, our devotion, our company, our smile, our time. May our eyes be opened to your holy presence, now and always. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I hope you are all staying healthy and safe, and that the service is bringing you comfort and peace. Before we begin our prayers of the people, I would like to take a moment to remember the victims and their families in the tragedy that unfolded in Nova Scotia this week. We extend our prayers and our sympathies for those people who have died in the shootings, that their souls may find love and peace. We take time to recognize that God is with us. Let us pray. Risen One, like those disciples on the road to Emmaus, we struggle to recognize you in the everyday journey of our lives. We seek your wisdom in the midst of the questions we have about the circumstances that we find ourselves in, circumstances sometimes beyond our control, but often of our own making. As we walk with you day by day, may your life be made manifest in what we say to others. Help us to understand the power of our words to hurt or to heal. Give us the graciousness to make all our conversations holy. Just as we desire that our speaking be holy, may our seeing be holy as well. We are bombarded with images every day, O Christ, that shape our attitudes and behaviors. As you open the scriptures to the disciples and taught them everything, open our eyes to behold you in your word, in the beauty of nature, the beauty of another human being, and the beauty of sacred art. Help us to recognize and welcome the stranger, even in our social distancing practice. May our welcome be a celebration of the gifts and graces of persons who are different from us. You were known to the disciples in the breaking of the bread. Help us to understand our eating and drinking as sacred events, not to be abused or approached mindlessly at this challenging time. O God, you invite us to abide with you, to have our lives hidden in you. We thank you that you travel with us in our joys and in our concerns. Amen.
Let us sing the closing hymn, Voice United, hymn number 173, Thine is the Glory.
So, and this is the bring us safe through Jordan to thy home above. Thine is the glory, risen from the sun, and this is the victory thou art yet has won.
Now let us walk our Emmaus road. Let us see and talk with our Lord Jesus Christ. My prayer is that we may all be able to recognize our risen Lord on the way. May the grace of Lord Jesus Christ, love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.